Today, we discuss about how in DBS platform we use Carbon Data to use the real-time insight, real-time analytics, and as well as the batch analytics by using the Carbon Data. To myself, Ravindra Besla, I'm a SVP and as well as a data platform lead at DBS, and also Apache Carbon Data PMC.
Hi all, I'm Ravi Sar. I'm personally a VP and digital engineer. I'm a professor of Apache Carbon Data.
So today we'll take you through today's agenda is we'll take you through the DBS platform architecture and streaming architecture. Then we'll explain about why we have chosen the Carbon Data as part of our platform. Later, my colleague Vishal will deep dive into the streaming design and explain the details how we integrated Carbon Data into our platform. And how we implemented the near real-time streaming ins made possible using the Carbon Data. So this is the DBS data platform architecture, which we internally call it as ADA. Before we are jumping into the architecture, I will just give few more details about how we come up with this architecture and why we have come up with this platform. As a bank, we have multiple departments like core banking, institutional banking, or trade markets, credit cards, loans, etc. So earlier to this platform, each department used to store their data in their own storages. So the data, all the data in silos. Okay, there is no proper clear data ownership, and you cannot retrieve the data properly, and there is no end-to-end insight of the data. So to overcome this problem, we come up with the common platform. So we have to use a common platform across the bank to get a better data insights. So main objective of this platform before building is to have a data discoverability, and every data which is ingested into this platform should be a metadata driven, and it should have to adhere to the data governance principle and the data security. As a bank, we have to follow all the data security principles as well, and each and every data or each data set which ingested should have a clear ownership, and moreover it should have the stable and as well as a scalable infrastructure. So we actually we are right now I can say more than 20-35,000 data sets right daily we are ingesting it, and we have around the size we have more than 50 TB of data we are ingesting daily. But this is part of the data, because still all other departments started ingesting or bringing the data into our common platform. So it is growing, the platform and as well as data sets, and as well as the size is also growing. So if you take when jump into the architecture, we have ingestion framework and as well as the compute framework. So this we have our own designers for this, and it is built. These are web-based designers. It's in-house built designers. And before going into the ingestion framework, the type of data we ingest is more important. Like we ingest the files like test, CSV, or JSON, Excel, binary files, or DB ingestion, or maybe we have API-based ingestions, which you can directly retrieve the data from the APIs and ingest into our platform. And we have a streaming ingestion. That is a batch that we receive the data from Kafka batch, or you can ingest real-time ingestion also using the Kafka batch, Kafka ingestion. So then we have a compute framework. This is the same actually, like we have a designer for this compute framework, others in that to that. So once we have built these jobs within the within this framework, use the jobs are stored in the as artifacts, So this, we have a clear version for these artifacts, and all these jobs are promoted to the higher environments using the artifact lifecycle manager. Like all the CI/CD management is maintained in this ALC manager. And this we have, so once it is built and deployed, it will, the jobs are deployed to the scheduler, job scheduler, that is Airflow, and as well as the job server. Here the Airflow we are using is for the dependency tracking as well as, and job server is used for the jobs management, like submitting the jobs or maybe the execution status submitting it to the underlying clusters. All this thing is managed with the job server. So when it goes to the visualization, we have a data as a service. And this is our in-house build service. This is used for since our applications are microservice applications. We need to provide as APIs. So we have provide the data as services. So we, this service will try to read get the data from the underlying storages, like from the S3 or from the HBase, and gives the, provides the data to the end users. And data visualization, we use multiple like SuperSet or BigQuery or Tableau, and we have our own data explorer and data quality extractor. Data science framework also we have. This is a separate department, separate team we have for it. I'm not going to explain more about it. Yeah, we use, this is a part of the tools we have currently we are using. It's much more it is. Yeah. And this important, one of the important layer is the data security. This is, we have one of our own data access control. This is the in-house built framework we have. And as well as data protection, we are using the enterprise data protection. And when it comes to the engines, data engines, we use Spark and Hive. So most of the jobs are Spark-based jobs for us. And for reading the data, we use MPPSQL engine, that is Presto engine. And depends on the type of nature of the data. If they want to use graph, we use Janus graph, and we have planned to use this near 4j as well. And for streaming, you have Kafka plus Spark we are using, and NoSQL, HBase, and Aerospark we are using, and deep learning, TensorFlow, and PyTorch, we are much more also using, and not this is part of it. And it comes to the storage, so we are using the S3 as the object storage, and the data when the data comes to the initially we call it as a S0. This is the raw data. It comes in multiple ways. It can be a test file wise, or it can be DB, or it can be a Kafka sourced Kafka topic. So once this data comes to the S0, then it goes to the cleaning phase, that we call it as ingestion. So the ingestion job will cleanse the data and apply these security principles and store into the S1 layer. That is, we are storing correctly in the Kafka data, some are called Parquet also. So, and we go to the type 2, that is the data models. So the common data models, the data objects we derive, which are the common data models across the data sets, and derive it, and they create the data models. And those also stored inside the Carbon and Parquet. And type 3 is the data marts. Here the data marts is like use case driven, these data marts are. So they also stored in Carbon Parquet and the other storages like HBase or some DB based conditions also. So these, from these data marts, usually users can generate reports, retrieve the data, and get into their applications. So this is the whole architecture we have. And let's go to this, jumping into the streaming architecture. So if you see the top side, I have the batch, and in the downside you have the streaming. So this is the batch flow and as well as the streaming flow. I'm not going to explain much about the batch flow, but streaming I like to explain. So here the starting point is, as I explained earlier, the S0. This is the S0 data landing. So the data is published to this source Kafka topic by various source systems. Like it can be a database event, CDC change events, master record events, or it can be a application events, app events, maybe all these events are published to the source Kafka, And it depends on the type of the data it has. Like there's a there could be two types of data. One is transactional nature of data, another one is SCD. We'll explain more in the latter details how it is how we have able to store the data, this SCD and transactional data inside the Kafka data. But usually the transaction data is the nature, like it's the append only data. So daily you will get the transaction, like a bank transaction. So every day you do some withdrawal or you credit card, it's a daily transaction. So it's append only nature transactions. Another one is SCD nature, so slowly changing, say like a dimension tables. You are updating, updating or adding the data inside your dimension tables. Like you, the simple example is your customer table. So if you are usually we have around more than 50 million of customers. So and you get maybe few thousands of updates daily on either maybe your customer address change or it can be a phone change, phone number change. So few thousands of data. Updates we get. So all these type of two types of data will be ingested into the to the add up like the T1 layer. That's a data cleansing. So first your streaming ingestion job, what it will do is just subscribe to this Kafka topic and does the cleansing, and I will apply the security principles and does the sync. Sync, it will store it into two places. One is to composite storage, and another one is the T1 Kafka topic. I'll explain why we are storing it to the two places. First is composite storage. What is composite storage? Here the composite storage comprises of two storages. One is HBase and another one is the Kafka. So here, why HBase is because of, as I explained, we have two types of data. One is transaction nature and another one is SCD. So for both actually, in case of, even it is append only, since we are storing in S3, they should have append only nature storage. So HBase is best fit for it. And as well as another one is the updation actually. You should have to update online. That's because if you are updating into the using the for SCD nature data, we have to update in the real time. The HBase is the best fit, and we gradually move this data from HBase to the Kafka in periodically. So if user wants to, there are two types of consumers here. One is the direct user. So the user can we have a Presto plugin developed for this. So this Presto plugin will retrieve the data from both HBase and Kafka in union and give it back. So as soon as the data ingested to the composite storage, it is available for the data, readily available for consumption. So user can consume data directly from the Presto business. Another one is the compute. So batch compute. So user can create another job, a batch compute job, and connect to the composite storage, and they can do a one more compute job and store it into the S3. This is as part of the T2 data model. So another, then we are storing parallel, we are storing into the T1 Kafka topic. This is a target topic, T1 Kafka topic. Why we are storing is because of if your T2, tier two model, you want to create a model in the real time. So user can connect to the T1 Kafka topic and they can create a compute job here. And the compute job is up to the user, how they want to join or they want to group by, all these things they can do it. And they apply the security principles here and do the sync again. Again, it is the same, it will repeat how it repeats here. It stores first in the composite storage. Parallel stores in the composite storage. And as well as it will do the sync to the T2 Kafka topic. So again, it's the same reason why we are storing into two places. Like in the T3 layer, if they want to do a real-time streaming, like directly consuming it from here, they can directly connect and create a compute job here, and they can write it to the T3, write it to the sync. Here we have two options here. User can write it to the composite storage plus T3 sync, or directly user can write it to the end storage. Like they can write direct to the HBase, or write to the direct to the Parquet, or maybe write direct to the MySQL. Depends on the use case they have it. So when you say here, all this data, it's in the pipeline. So first user can publish it to the source Kafka topic, and immediately this will be published to the T1, and in the real time it will be published to the T2, and real time it will be published to the T3. So all will be published in the real time. And as well as soon as published in the composite storage, as soon as stored in the composite storage, it will be readily available for the consumption by the user. So this is the high level architecture of the streaming. So here I'll explain about why we have chosen the Kafka data in the first place. why you come to the decision like choosing the carpenter here. So one problem is the small fry problem. This is the industry-wide problems. So since depends upon the data set nature, there are some data sets that have a small fries are because of because you have a real problem with our split spark splits also. Sometimes it creates small splits, and that also leads to the partition spark partition problem. That also leads to the small fights. So we are solving by using the Akatam version of the carbon. Another one is supporting the tables without partitions and as well as without our non-incremental partitions. So right now, if you see currently when you are loading it, daily we are loading a data set, daily loading the data into the table. So when you are loading the data into a table, incrementally, usually we are taking every day we are getting one date partition and we are loading the data. Even though we don't require the date partition, still we are forced to create the date partition because we require to create an isolation here. Like if my load is failed, so I can directly remove that partition and I can reload that partition. So without this partition, I don't want, but still we are forced to create. So because of this reason, there are a lot of partitions are getting created in the hive. Okay, even we don't require it. And second problem is there are small file problems again comes back because I cannot compact across the partitions even if you want to compact it. So this can be solved by using our carbon segments. So this it can give the ASIC type of transactions and as well as proper snapshot isolation while reading the data. And another one is the STD, as I told earlier, STD, we have many data sets have STD nature. So usually we get few updates, but even though we get few updates, we are forced to rewrite the complete data. So because of there is no update features in the traditional big data. So we use the carbon simple to merge and STD features. So we find out what exactly needs to be updated and what actually needs to create a history row, and we create it and use this feature to improve the performance a lot. And another way, slow filter query performs response. So you don't have a driver side pruning in the traditional one. So we use this carbon to prune the indexes, prune these filter queries using the indexes in the driver side itself. And as well as it depends on the nature, we use the second indexes to accelerate the queries. And the other one is update deletes. So here, there are use cases like we need to update the history data. Like if users are leaving the bank, we may require to mask their data, or we need to delete the data. So we occasionally have to apply these deletes updates. So with those carbon, we are forced to rewrite the complete data again and again. So by using this feature or carbon IUD, we just update and delete those particular records only within seconds or minutes. Another one is before going to the live streaming, I need to explain about why we have chosen the HBase as a staging. So as I explained earlier, we have a STD scenario. So we should be able to do this update delete operation quite faster. So this is the best fit. HBase is the best fit for it. And another one is the implement exactly one semantic data. So this is the common problem if you use the Kafka streaming. Like it can be because of the publisher maybe publishing twice, or maybe your consumer maybe because of a crashing scenario maybe replaying the same data again. Because of this nature, you may end up with duplicate data. So that can be solved using this uniqueness, the data uniqueness inside the HBase. Otherwise, duplicate checks, this is also similar to the above, but here the data itself is like that, but we need to clean up that duplicates from our side. So even the HBase, we should be able to find out which is duplicate or not. And if it is duplicate, we can forward that to a rejectable. And another one is late arrival data. This is another problem, common problem in the Kafka in your streaming cases. So if there is any data which comes late, we should be able to go back and update those data. That is possible if you use the HBase. And managing the stream-to-stream joins. As earlier explained, we are using the HBase as our staging. So we should be able to join, like if you use Spark Stream, Spark joins, you need to use the watermarking, and you should be able to give the time, like what till what time, like 1 hour or 2 hour, what time you keeps in the memory, and you do those joins. But if you use this HBase, I should be able to join, like I no need to do all the shuffling, all these things. You just do a point lookup and find out the data and get the data and do the join. So that it will be, it is very helpful and faster also for our case. And when it comes to the why Carbon is using for the streaming, so basically since we are using HBase is for staging, so HBase is actually not meant for the analytical queries. So if you hit, if you create some group by query or maybe if I do a control queries, or join queries, it's not meant for it. Scanning is, it become very slow and it will add too much load on the HBase. So we have to move this data to the underlying storage, to the Carbon, as soon as possible. So that's why you choose Carbon. And when you are moving it, we should able to apply this IUD operations also, I mean SED operations also to it. So we actually for moving, we are using the header handoff. So we use the handoff to move the data from Carbon to HBase to Carbon. And another problem is we are doing more frequent movements. Every 10 minutes or 5 minutes, we move the data from HBase to the Carbon. So in those cases, it may lead to the small files. So we use the Carbon compaction. That's the Carbon compaction we use to solve this issue. Another one, as I explained earlier, mimicking this HBase IUD on for the Carbon actually. So yeah, for SED cases, we need to do the update delete operations. But when it goes to the Carbon, what we'll do is with same operations, whatever the update delete operations happen, we mimic the same onto the Carbon while moving. So that will help to this movement also be quite faster actually. So here we are using this IUD intelligent merge. So here in the next version, basically we are implementing this into the Carbon or open source as well. Okay, next will or my colleague Vishal will tell more about the composite storage. Thank you.
Hi again. Now we'll discuss about this real-time ingestion use cases, and then we'll discuss about the how this actually real-time SCD works in details, and how composite data storage hand off the data, and how we are reading data from the composite data storage. So first about this is about real-time data ingestion, real-time ingestion use case. Real-time ingestion use case, we have basically two scenarios. One is transactional engine, one is transactional use case, and second one is SCD use case. Transactional scenario is like a simple append. Whenever data comes to the system, whenever data comes to the source, we append the data to the HBase table. Next is we directly append to the HBase table. Next is SCD. SCD case, in here, what we maintain two tables. One is open table and another one is closed table. Open table always maintains the current record, and closed table maintains the history record. So when any new batch comes here to the SCD engine, first it does the lookup to the open table, and it checks whether the new batch, which records is updated and which all records are newly inserted. It's new record. So based on that, what it does here, it will insert the new record to the new and updated record to the open table, and the old record, history record, it will move to the closed table. History and deleted record also, it will move to the closed table. And then in the same time, for the streaming case, we are maintaining one staging table, it's a replication of the open table, which maintain the same record as open table. But it maintains one extra flag, which is like IUD flag, where it maintains whether the record was inserted, it's a new record, whether the record was deleted, or whether the record was updated. So it maintains a flag. This staging table will be used during the handoff from HBase to Carbon. Now, this is real-time SCD. We are showing through one example. Here it's a new streaming batch. Here we are getting like row ID 2, 3, 4, 5. And this is current open table status.
Current tuple contains record number from 1, 2, 3, 10,001 till 10,003. So here you can see 10,002 and 10,003 is getting updated, and 10,004 and 5 is getting it's a new record which is not present in the open table. So this SND engine, first it will read the data. It will based on the row key, it will read the data. It will check, okay, this record was updated or it's a completely new record. So all the records which are updated or new record, it will directly write to the open table. And then the old record, here you can see 10,002 and 10,003, it will move to the closed table. And then after this, what it does here, it will same record 10,002, 3, 4, and 5, it will insert into the staging table, but it will write one extra column, which is operation type. This shows whether this record was updated or inserted, or if there can be scenario like it's a deleted from the open table. And this staging table, same staging table is used during the handoff. So now this is the way we handle the SCD. Now we'll move to the carbon data composite storage, right? This composite carbon data composite storage, here we maintain what basically it's required to move the data from HBase to carbon to support a faster analytical query. So while moving the data here, we have three types of tables. One is master open table, next is master closed table, and end transactional table. So for master open table, carbon also does the same SCD operation. For the master closed table and transactional table, it is always append case. So for master table, we are, as I already earlier I have mentioned, we are storing the data to staging table with a flag. It uses this flag to move the data and applies the SCD in while moving the data from HBase to carbon. And for closed table and transaction, it directly append the data to carbon. So this here is Spark streaming system, when it's directly writing the data to real time IoT. It's writing the data to HBase using this SCD, real-time SCD. And then when this system starts here, it first registers itself to carbon. So while registering, it passes to two things. One is HBase table column table schema, and next is incremental column information. So and this same information we store in the segment metadata. And at the same time, it creates one streaming segment, which is just logical. So anytime if we are reading from the streaming segment, it will read directly through the HBase. It won't store only anything. It's just a logical segment. So now, here we provide one data handoff. So this Spark system trigger handoff periodically. It triggers the handoff like X interval. By default, it is 10 minutes. So whenever it triggers the handoff, first it will read the streaming segment metadata. In the streaming segment metadata, we store the HBase row timestamp. What was the last row we added to carbon? What was the max of that row timestamp? So after reading this, it will read those records from HBase which is greater than this this current timestamp. So after reading those records from the HBase, then it will move those records to batch segments. So movement of those records means it will convert this, it will write to carbon format. So while writing to the batch segments, it checks whether it's a SCD scenario or it's a append scenario. If it is a append scenario, it will directly write the data. If it is a SCD scenario, it will check, okay, it will apply the SCD, okay, and then it will write the data to batch segments. So after writing the data, it will write the new metadata. So while writing new metadata is like incremental column. Incremental column is like any timestamp column. We are timestamp column and HBase row timestamp column. This incremental column will be used during the query for pruning the segments. And same time, it writes the batch segment metadata. This batch segment metadata contains all the column min-max values, which will be helpful during the pruning. And after this writing this metadata, again, it triggers the, after that, it will trigger the compaction only for the batch segments. So here, this compaction basically checks for the small files. It will compact those small segments. It will create a big segment. So to avoid the small files problem and to accelerate the performance. So this is done. This is the right part here. Like we can see, like it's a unified storage here. This orange line duplicates. It's showing a composite storage, means we are using Carbon plus HBase, and this red dotted line is showing a Carbon data storage, which is stored on top of S3. So this current orange, this orange line is the composite data. We call it as a composite data storage. So we can see like it's a unified storage, real time data to HBase, and periodically we are moving the data from HBase to Carbon. Real time SCD we are applying on the HBase, and while moving the data from HBase to Carbon, we are applying the SCD. And auto compaction, auto compaction is solving the this small files problem. So now we'll check the read part. So any like any system, if like here we use Preston Spark for the query engine. So whenever any system fires the query to Spark, first it will ask the composite data Carbon composite data plugin to give me the splits. So this we have developed in DBS, Carbon data composite plugin and segment tuner. So first it asks for the splits. So based on the query condition, it decides which storage it will read the data. So while if query is a point query, so directly it will redirect it to HBase, and it will return the HBase region splits. If it is analytical query, then it will ask the segment pruner based on the filter condition to prune the segment. So while pruning the segment, this segment pruner will read the segment metadata, and after that it will apply the min-max. Once this min-max, after applying the min-max, it will remove some unnecessary, unrequired segments. After doing this, it will return only those segments which is valid for this particular query. So once this segment pruner does its work and return the set of segments, so there can be two scenarios. One is like three scenarios basically. One is like, okay, only I mentioned earlier, we are using incremental column, like for example, timestamp column. My query condition is less than some particular timestamp, and from this metadata we know, okay, my data is already moved to Carbon, so we'll return only the Carbon segment information. If my query is like greater than particular timestamp, and from the metadata I'll read, and I'll from the metadata I can decide, okay, this data is not moved to Carbon, okay, it's present in HBase, so I'll redirect those queries to Apache HBase, okay. And then if between query condition, when I'm fetching data both from the Carbon and HBase, it will return both segments. So after this, this Carbon data composite plugin will return the splits based on in case of HBase region based splits, and in case of Carbon it will return the Carbon block splits. So and then this Spark driver or Presto coordinator will ask its executor or worker to read the data from the executor based on this splits provided by the Carbon data composite plugin. So this Carbon data composite plugin and segment pruner is developed in here in DBS. Okay, so this read part you can see here, it's a real time data access. If suppose when streaming this streaming system is writing continuously to HBase, so that data will be always available. Smart filtering, we choose the storage based on the query condition, filter applied on the query condition, and in the segment pruner we prune segment, we select only those segments which is valid for that filter condition, and this way we save resources. Faster point query, because point query will always point to the HBase, so HBase is known for the point query scenario, so it will be always faster. So this is that's it from my end. Now we'll move to the next part. Thank you.
As a whole summary, we have achieved here by using the Carbon data in our platform is the real-time ingestion with the millisecond latency, really. We should able to, we are able to ingest the data in the near real time, the millisecond latency from one layer to other, like T0 to T1, T1 to T2, T2 to T3, and as well as our real time SCD. But this is one of our important feature. We are able to do that using this Carbon Data Composite Storage. And for the batch wise, actually, we use by using this Carbon Data Merge feature, we are able to improve this SCD ingestion by 50% compared to the earlier ingestion, and we are able to give the to the faster query responses by using the indexes, and we solve this small file problems by for the actually with the, without partitions actually by using these auto compaction features, and as well as we are able to do this carbon IUD feature for by using this update deletes. We are able to update the history data whenever is needed. So, and one important thing I should able to tell is this STD carbon merge feature. We are contributing to the we have improved a lot, and we are able to benchmark against the Hudi, and we should be much faster than both copy and write, and as well as read and merge. We are going to release it in our next version. And yeah. Last but not least, please join our Apache community, Carbon Data community, and please start contributing to our community. Thank you very much.
Thank you.